Thank you all very much for coming today. I think we have a great panel for you. My name is Megan Abella-Bowen. I'm the Associate Dean for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math here at Bristol Community College, and we're very excited about our STEM panel today. I'm going to pass it over here quickly to have a welcome. I do want to let you know that President Spraga wanted to be here to welcome you today, but he was unable due to another conflicting meeting that he needed to go to. But he did want to extend his welcome to everybody. And then we'll do a quick welcome from actually the woman I wanted to come in and welcome you today, our Associate Vice President of Academic Affairs, Anna Gayet, I always say it incorrectly, who actually has quite an extraordinary background in chemistry. So I thought she would be a perfect person to welcome you today. And then we'll get you going, tell you a little bit about how the process is going to work today. But this is very much an opportunity for you to ask questions and to be engaged. So don't hesitate to really start thinking about what those questions might be and to take advantage of the panelists that we have here today. So right now, Anna.
Thank you.
Good morning, how are you? Quite an outstanding background in chemistry. I haven't done chemistry in a long while, but I'm a chemist by training. I'm originally from Argentina. You can probably hear my accent. And I did my undergrad over there, and then I came to the U.S. to do my master's and my PhD at UMass Amherst. So I started loving sciences when I was more or less your age, but it was always that thing of like, do I, don't I? If somebody would have told me when I was your age that I was going to be here addressing you guys, I would have gone, what did you have for breakfast? It would have been totally out of my mind. But if you really line things up, and if you really plan, and if you really start doing things early on, the sky's the limit. You can really go wherever you want. I'm not going to talk so much about myself. I'm going to talk about my daughter, because I'm a proud mama. And a couple of years back, when she was in middle school, she comes in one day and says, Mom, do you think I should go to college? And I looked at her as like, middle school? You're already talking about college? Yes. Hey, I work in the industry, so I might as well. So I said, yeah, what are you asking? Well, some of my friends are saying that that's not for girls. And I was like, oh, wait a second. Hey, look at me. I'm just one of many women that have gone to college, have had successful careers. You have a whole bunch in here. And you can do whatever you dream you can do. Well, you know what we did last night? We spent a couple hours looking at grad schools. She's considering her PhD in biomedical engineering right now. She's graduating next year from UMass Dartmouth with a degree in bioengineering. She wants to work in prosthesis and into the development of biomedical systems for human beings. So that little middle school girl has blossomed into somebody that's now looking at doctorates. Is making me feel old, but that's perfectly fine. I'm very happy seeing that if you have a dream and you put a plan in place and you take the steps that it takes to develop that dream will come to pass. She wanted to be a researcher, she wanted to do things, and she didn't wait until somebody waved the magic wand that made it happen. She started taking the math classes and the biology classes and the chemistry classes. I'm really working step by step by step. And here she is now looking at PhD programs. So that's the same thing that you can do. A dream without a plan is just a wish. That's a pretty often repeated story. You need to have that plan that's gonna take you from point A to point B. Life happens, we know that. But if you don't have a plan, you're a victim of life instead of being the architect of your own life. So dream big, put your plan in place, take it one step at a time, and don't let anybody tell you you can't. You can, the sky's the limit, keep going. Welcome to BCC, have a wonderful day, and enjoy everything that has been prepared for you. Thank you for coming.
So we're going to get started this morning. A couple of quick things. In your folders, you do have a bio. You have a page that gives a biography on each of the individuals here today. So if you don't catch all their information, please feel free to, you know, read up on them through there. Secondly, for those of you who have the opportunity and the ability to stay with us, we will be going over to lunch, and I believe most of our panelists are going to be able to go with us to lunch. So it'll give you an opportunity to ask additional questions. So if you feel a little bit uncomfortable raising a question in the middle of the presentation, know that you have an opportunity to talk with many of them one-on-one during our lunch time. And finally, let me just do a couple of opening pieces here. And then what we'll be doing today, the goal is we'll do two presenters at a time. That will give you a chance to hear their stories. And then you can ask questions, and we've kind of grouped them together as engineers, life sciences, computer systems, and biochemistry. You two ladies kind of came in the middle and let you ask those questions. So again, feel free to ask those questions at that time. Also, at the very end of the presentation, we'll open the floor so you can ask questions to the whole group. So again, kind of keep those in mind as you're going along. And again, don't hesitate to ask those questions of them. So today, just a couple of quick things. If you didn't know, yesterday was the International Women's Day. And International Women's Day, as I sit here and I can't read my stuff. International Women's Day is celebrated in many countries around the world. It's a day when women are recognized for their achievements without regard to divisions, whether national, ethnic, linguistic, cultural, economic, or political. And International Women's Day first emerged from the activities of the labor movements at the turn of the 20th century in North America and across Europe. It's important still today. If you're paying attention, there's a lot of conversation today about equity and pay. This is just one of the many areas that we need to be focused on, and we need to make sure that our women today are getting the pay that they ought to be getting for doing the same kinds of jobs that men are doing. And it takes active women to be out there in the forefront to push that agenda forward. So it might be something you might even hear a little bit from some of our folks today as they're talking about some of the things they do outside of their work. So again, today's program, you probably hear the word STEM a lot. It's become the big buzzword. It stands for science, technology, engineering, and math. And there's also been a lot of conversation around that the U.S. needs more workers in the STEM field. That these are the folks that use their math and their science to basically solve problems. And we need women in that role as well, because women bring other things to the table. They bring ideas, they think differently in many ways, and so it's important to make sure that we have good teams that include all people. Another couple of good things you're going to hear from our six speakers today, but this is your opportunity while they're here to ask them questions. Why did they choose to do what they do? Specific questions about their jobs, because some of them hold some very intriguing jobs in some areas that you may not be familiar with. So definitely ask questions about that. And also about their paths. Many of them didn't take a perfectly linear path to where they are today. And again, it's important for students to kind of understand that where you start and where you end may not be what you thought, just as Anna Gayet just mentioned to us. And finally, the last part of it is our STEM workforce is crucial in our innovative economy today, and we need to have everybody engaged. Right now, women make up about 50% of the workforce, but they're not as well represented in STEM. Now, that's not completely a fair statement, because in areas like the biologies, the biological sciences, the medical sciences, women are doing a great job. In computer science and in engineering, we tend to fall behind, and so we definitely want to look at that. But at the same token, we're doing well in getting our degrees, but we may not be staying with industry. So that may be some other conversations you want to have with our panelists today. What's helping them to stay engaged in industry? Why are they there? And how can they help themselves? And you'll see on their bios that many of them are engaged in programs at their own companies that focus on women initiatives and women, you know, supporting one another. So I think those are great things. So with that, I'm going to start the conversation. I'm going to give you just a little bit of background on each of them. Again, their bios are in your folder, so I'm not going to go through the whole bio. And then I'm going to let them tell their story. So we're going to start off with Sharon Elder. Thank you so much. Sharon has over 20 years of experience in the medical device field and is currently a technical service compliance business lead at DePuy Synthes Mitek. That's up in Raynham, Mass, for those of you who might be familiar. In her career, Sharon has held positions of product development engineer, manufacturing engineer, and a quality engineer. Sharon holds a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from Penn State University and a master's degree in manufacturing systems engineering from New Jersey Institute of Technology and volunteers her time as DePuy's Women's Leadership Initiative co-lead, is also involved in Habitat for Humanity, American Cancer Society, Parkwood Beach Association Board of Directors, and Women for Women International. So thank you very much, and we'll pass it over to
Sharon. There's also, you can have a choice. You can either stand up here if you feel more comfortable, or we also have them on the table.
Okay, yeah, I'll stand for now.
Okay.
So maybe we'll take the questions, you can sit down. Hi, everybody. I wanted to thank Megan for inviting me today. I'm really happy to be here. And yesterday I was reflecting about International Women's Day, so it's nice that you mentioned that. And thinking about my path career-wise and also my college path. So Megan gave you a brief bio, kind of taken from my resume. But the message that I want to give you is that it took me many, many years to get those degrees and have that experience in my career. So for my bachelor's degree, I didn't go to college right away. It took me 5 years to start taking classes at a satellite campus in Penn State and New York, Pennsylvania, where I grew up. And it took me 8 years to get my bachelor's degree, and I didn't really know, like, we talk about this path and you know, setting things up, and it seems as if when people look back that they knew exactly where they were going and how they were going to get there and what they wanted to do. And I'm just here to tell you that I didn't know all those things. So I just want to make sure that you realize that for me, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but that I took the little steps and focused on the class that I was taking. And really, it was my stubbornness of saying, okay, I'm going to get this degree, and not, you know, stopping along the way. I did have a lot of life experiences, and I've been hearing that phrase, that life happens. So I had a lot of things happen in my life that, you know, my path wasn't like this. It was more like this. So some of the things that happened along the way, I needed to stop taking classes. My mother passed away at some point, and I needed to help support my brother. Also along the way, I got married and I had a child, which was the greatest thing, but it wasn't planned. So for me to finish my bachelor's degree, I ended up having to take some online classes, and they needed to be electives. So I took children's literature so that my homework could be sitting with my baby reading books. So I think one of the messages is really that, you know, part of being an engineer for me is being creative and applying those creative solutions, not only in my workplace, but also to my own life. So that's just like one example of kind of a creative solution. And I think that's one of the things that women engineers, at least in my experience, tend to have in common, is that we approach problems from different avenues and can really bring some creativity and different energy to the technical problems that we solve as engineers. So I have got my bachelor's, moved to New Jersey with my husband, and worked in an R&D field at Stryker, which is also a medical company. My degree was mechanical engineering. I didn't plan on getting into biomedical, but I was able to get a job because I had a CAD background. So my first job was a contract engineer, and then I was able to get a permanent job as an engineer at the medical company. And then along the way, again, you know, I wanted to get my master's. It was important for me to keep getting my education. But I again had some life situations that happened. My husband passed away, I became a single parent, my son was 6 years old. So I tried a few times to start my master's degree, and I just couldn't finish the class. So I had to wait until my son was in high school, and then I started going back to, I was in New Jersey, and I started going back to take classes for my master's. It took me almost 5 years, but I have my master's now. So again, I just wanna make sure that I emphasize that, you know, as you're sitting there, maybe it's not clear exactly. Maybe it is clear, and that's fantastic, but if it's not clear to you exactly where you want to go, if you're interested in science and math, and not meaning that you have to be a straight-A student in calculus, but if you're somebody who's curious, if you like to solve problems, you like puzzles, you like to understand how things work and come at it from a creative point of view. I think as women engineers, we really contribute and move things forward in a very different direction. And it's so exciting, it's so great for me to see everybody here. When I got my bachelor's degree, I was the only woman in my class. So it's great to see this many women here. I think that's really kind of sums up my path and my background. And again, it wasn't this. You know, now I really like my job. I continue to change my roles. I took a new position last year and completely changed things up for myself. I'm traveling. I lived in China for a year and a half a few years ago. My company sent me there. So there's a lot of places that engineering can take you, and you know, just want to share that experience.
Yeah, sure. Yep. So our next person.
Those are mine.
I know. I'm in the same boat. It's like, yeah. You know, life is getting tough when everybody's grabbing for the same glasses.
Great. So our next speaker is Ashley Bergeron, and like I mentioned, after that, then Jennifer, and I apologize, my colleague here, Jennifer Deckers Mitchell, she's going to actually step up in between and work the questions as they come up. So after Ashley finishes, please feel free to ask all the questions that you'd like. Ashley Bergeron is a design engineer technician at Sensata Technologies in the heavy vehicle off-road department. So she works with Cat, John Deere, Cummins, and Mack trucks. Her main responsibilities include design test fixtures and test sensor devices and recreating the environment which these sensors may have to endure in their lifetime, ensuring they will survive the elements of vibration, salt, mechanical shock, electric shock, miswriting, and anything else the customers want Sensata to test. That could cause the sensors to fail. Ashley is currently a student at Wentworth Institute of Technology. She's working towards obtaining her Bachelor's of Science degree in project management and works as a robotics teacher at Wamsutta Middle School. She is also a graduate of BCC in our engineering technology program with her concentration in electromechanical. I will put a shout out to her. She was also one of my very active women in STEM students, and she did many, many outreach presentations with me at local high schools. She also has a background. Previously, she worked for TriMac Plastics Manufacturing, where she was also a CNC operator, an assembly worker, and basic quality inspection. So she has quite a diverse background. So again, something that you might want to take from her presentation today as well. Ashley, your choice. You can either sit there. There's a microphone if you feel more comfortable, or you can come up and speak at the.
Too tall for me?
In 1 feet.
So, I'm Ashley Bergeron, work at Sensata Technologies. I'm still on my path. It took me a while to get back from college after high school. I wanted to be a kid. I wanted to go out and hang out with my friends, and going to school would not allow me to do that. I didn't realize I wanted to go into engineering until I was in high school, because I went to New Bedford Folk, I had my exploratory, and my parents were trying to lead me into the medical, dental field, something traditional, I guess you could say. So I started taking these exploratories, and I got 104 in diesel, 101 in welding, 80 in medical, and like a 90 in dental. So I started looking at that, thinking there's a pattern. I got into engineering, and they told me I could do all of those majors if I wanted to. I could do plumbing, I could do medical, I can do dental, I can do whatever I want. So I ended up picking engineering, and then my second choice was, I want to say medical. They called me sophomore year, asked me if I wanted to go to medical. I said no, because I really liked engineering. So after high school of trying to have fun, I went back to college, realized I needed to do it. It took me about 4 years to get an associate's degree. Being active with Megan, I think that really pushed me through. And remember why I want to do it. Come to the schools, talk to students, try it. It really kind of brought out the bright side of everything. We went on quite a few field trips to Maker's Faire, got to meet a lot of really cool people. And then I ended up landing a job at TriMac, where they need aerospace parts. Pretty much anything plastic, bushings, anything to do with planes, they made and manufactured there. So getting that job was kind of a little bit of a boost for me, like, wow, okay, I'm going back to college, and I got a job, this is really, really cool. So once I graduated, I found Sensata. Now, Sensata had come here a year before that and spoke to students, said you need an associate's degree. I never thought that I'd actually end up working there. So I had my interview there, I got the job, and it's a completely different experience. They gave me my own laptop, they gave me my own cubicle, a bunch of tools, which was kind of like my own candy land in there. So, and then yeah, I volunteered at a shop every once in a while to help with like basic car stuff, like spark plugs and, you know, silly tune-ups and stuff like that. But I really like it there, and I have to say what she said, and your path is probably not going to be a straight path. You have to remind yourself constantly why you're doing what you do. You have to stay strong. If it was going to be easy for everybody, everybody would be doing it. So you have to remember, you have to do it for yourself. You can't do it for your parents. You can't do it for your friends. It has to be strictly for you to make yourself a better person. And have fun with it. Get involved.
Questions for our first two candidates. Don't be shy. Yes, Kelly,
I don't need a
mic in the back.
Both of you did not start right after high school. Now, I am the traditional, I followed that straight line. Even when things deviated me, I'm that stubborn and OCD that I had to follow that straight line. Did you find that it helped you make a better decision, or would you have rather you had made the choice to keep that, you know, go right after high school? Or did you feel like your experiences allowed you to make a better educated decision as to which path you want?
Yeah. So for me, I thought I wanted to be a journalist when I was in high school. I liked to write poetry and write newspaper articles. And I didn't start college because, practically speaking, I didn't have the money and I didn't have the support from my parents to pay for it. So I can't say that it was like, you know, I was discovering what I wanted to do and that sort of thing. It was more practical for me. I did realize that, you know, I still like to write. I still, you know, that's one of my hobbies. But I needed to get a full-time job. My father helped me get a job doing CAD drafting. Pre-CAD, and I realized that I liked that technical, you know, area. And if I wanted to, if I wanted to advance and I wanted to, you know, improve my position, I needed to go to college. So,
I'd say both my parents didn't go to college, so I thought I didn't have to go to college. So I have to say that my experience has made me a better person. It made me realize that I really did want to do this for myself. Made me realize that the world won't hand you everything, you have to work for it. I think that's something that a lot of people struggle with today. So I feel like in some ways it was good, in some ways it was bad. I wonder to myself, like, if I stayed with it and stayed with my clear shot, I probably would have gotten a lot further, but I probably wouldn't be involved at nearly as much.
Any other questions? Yes?
Would you say that your major in college would limit you to like a specific type of job? Like, I'm interested in mechanical engineering, but I also really love art and design. So I was wondering, like, if I majored in mechanical engineering, would I solely have to do mechanical engineering, or are there other options?
So does your major kind of determine your career path, right?
I also, my bachelor's degree is mechanical engineering, and I picked that because it seemed like it was broad enough that I'd have more choices when I finished. So for me, that was the decision that I made. But I think it's great if you know that you're also interested in art and design. You know, if you continue to pursue that besides your classes, I can wholeheartedly say that you can, you know, you can get a position in something that's not just strictly, you know, making gears for cars, you know? So, and I think, you know, once you get that first job, once you have your degree, there are a lot of options that open up, and employers, I think especially today are really looking for a diverse background. So I think, you know, I think it's absolutely possible. So.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yes.
Out of all the positions you've held, what's your favorite?
What's my favorite?
Yeah.
I think I want to say my favorite is right now, which is really good. So for me, I worked in R&D and manufacturing and quality. I'm in an industry that is regulated by the FDA, so quality is really, it's always important, but it's especially important. And now I'm working with the devices that are staying at the hospital and need to be repaired and upgraded, so I'm a lot closer to working in the hospitals and seeing patient lives improve, and that's rewarding for me. So for me, using my engineering, my technical skills to help people and make their lives better is the best thing for me. Like it's really meaningful for me. So I think right now is probably my best job. So.
Anybody else have a question for anyone to the next two? Speakers? All right. So remember, don't be shy. Next round's coming up.
Can I ask you a question before I start? How many, by a show of hands, people here in the room who are planning to go to college kind of know where they want to go, what they want to take as a major? I am, exactly like all of you. I knew in fourth grade, because I won a drawing contest, that I was going to go to school and be an artist. And I'd like to venture a guess that I probably am the oldest person on this panel today. I'm from a generation where all of my friends were the first in their families to go to college. And I was lucky. My mother, who was born in 1920, was a college attendee in her generation, which was really, really unusual. So for me, there was no choice but to go to college. I was gonna go. But in that generation also, it was pretty much expected that you would be a nurse, a teacher, or a secretary. And so that was pretty much the path most of my women friends or girlfriends at the time were taking. I can tell you today that I don't think I still have a friend who, well, I still have friends who are nurses, but I think all the rest of them have gone on to other kinds of careers, even though they might have started as nurses, secretaries, and administrative assistants. I mean, teachers. So, fourth grade, knew I was gonna be an artist. Got to that time when I told my parents, go into art school. And of course my father and mother wanted to know what was I gonna do with that. And I said, well, I'll figure it out. So 4 years I went to art school. I went to Mass Art and I went to to Montserrat School of Visual Art. And midway through that, I decided, well, maybe making money as an artist, because we were allowed to do that as school children, may not be the smartest idea career-wise. So I kind of switched over to illustration, photography, and graphic design, keeping my fine art minors going at the same time. So I did, I graduated, I went in to be a graphic designer, I started working for a printing company, so I kind of got to know all kinds of people and industries to do creative design for. And then I got married, I have two daughters, I'm gonna segue into my two daughters for a moment to answer your question. I have one daughter who, just like me, was very, very bright, went through school and decided she was going to go to art school. And she's the kind of person who can ace her biology exam. In fact, she got a perfect score in her MCASs. And she can ace a biology exam by never opening a book. This is her style of learning. My other daughter has difficulty reading and then giving back the information. So she has to experience her learning. And she went to Bridgewater State University. And now she's an environmental biologist. For those of you who ever go into the sciences and really struggle with it, I'm going to give you a good inspirational story. My daughter took 6 years to get her bachelor's degree from Bridgewater State. And every time she took chemistry, it was a dismal failure, except for the third time. But each time she did it, I said to her, Leah, you will get a little bit closer next time. Just who cares? Nobody cares that you failed biology or you failed chemistry in your freshman year. 5 years from now, is anybody gonna say to you, hey, did you fail chemistry? No, they don't care. You just stick to it, keep going, and as long as you are trying, we are going to help you get there. So she took chemistry 3 times. It was excruciating. And on her 3rd time, she came up with a 3.5, which is amazing. So she got through that. She now goes on whale watches in out of Plymouth. She does whale research. Recently, she's gotten away from going to do Target or CVS type jobs in the winter when she can't be on a boat. And she's working for Tower Hill Botanic Garden, being kind of a plant specialist in the winter. So she's doing a great job. And I just want you to have that story in the back of your hand, on your mind there for a while, as you think about how difficult it can be. Just persevere. My oldest daughter will tell you that whenever she got a B in anything, I was mad as all get out at her, because I knew she could do better. And if her sister got a C+ in something, I'd be saying, "Great job, Leah." And she would say, "Mom, why are you telling her she did a great job when you won't even praise me for getting a B?" And I would say to her, "Because she's doing the absolute best she can do." And that, to me, is the most important thing. Actually, professors from Bridgewater State, because as you know, I'm from Fitchburg State, have actually spoken to me about what an inspiration she was in the efforts that she made to succeed at being an environmental biologist. So it's all in the effort that you put in. Anyway, getting back to me. So I got on, I got married, I had the 2 daughters. I was, by that time, freelancing, because I really couldn't be spending a lot of time. Graphic design can be very time intensive. So I was spending a lot of time at home, because I bought my first Macintosh computer with a whopping 40 megabytes of memory back when Leah was born in 1987. And I was doing freelance at home, which was great until my husband got a job in Colorado and we up and moved. So at that time, believe it or not, there was a time before internet. You could not do long distance kind of work. You had to be kind of in the vicinity of your customers. So I was kind of out of business. But because I had made a transition from graphic design to computerized graphic design, I had to get my way around the computer pretty well, and I knew more about computers than most people in the school system in Evergreen, Colorado. So with a brief stop at being a school nurse, which I won't go into right now because I can't stand the sight of blood, and it wasn't a really good thing for me. But for about a semester of being a school nurse, they finally said to me, "Do you think you could run the computer lab for us, because nobody else knows how to do it?" And I had already been fixing people's computers around the school. So I said, "Sure." And they put in a big bank of Macintosh computers. I was at home. I got them all set up and running. I got them networked. I actually got them on the internet. It was amazing. In fact, my best friend back in Princeton would, and she was doing the same thing at the school in Princeton, we both would send each other an email and then call each other that night to find out if we got the email and just discuss what was going on in the email. So we put our email together so that we would save money on the long distance phone calls back and forth between Colorado, but we spent more money on the phone because we were calling each other to see if the email was working. Anyway. That led me to come back to Massachusetts and be so proficient, I decided to become the district computer technical support person for the Wachusett Regional School District. In 5 towns, 13 schools, and the first time they were all going to be computerized. So it was me against a whole community that had never been technologically challenged before, and believe me, they were challenged. So I took that on. Excuse me. Got everything up and running, worked there for 2 years, was offered a job at Fitchburg State, and went there. And so I kind of morphed my graphic design artistic background into computer technician, because I was the only one who knew it. Now, it's very, very common that women will go into technical support. They'll be help desk managers. And why do you suppose that is? Anybody want to hazard a guess? What do you think, what characteristic of a woman's personality would help them help someone else understand technology? It's empathy and compassion. Oddly enough, because we are willing to say, "Oh, you don't understand that. Okay, I can help you with that." We're talkative, we're interactive, and so we make great technical support people. Men tend to be a little bit more about the machine and a little bit about the programming and about the background. We are more of those people who want to talk to people. We want to have the interaction. So it's a great, great career for a woman. Anyway, so I went to be a help desk person, and then pretty soon I was learning from the guys in the office how to manage the systems. So when you go into education, there's not a lot of money for everybody to specialize in one little thing. So you can't just be a help desk person or just be a systems administrator. You have to kind of be involved in everything. So next thing I knew, I was the system administrator. And then, because I had experience in both the technology and the people part of it, they said, you know what, you'd make a great project manager because you'd be able to figure out how to get the people working and get the technology together and work with these people who can do the programming and work with those people who can set the systems up. And by the way, you can do it yourself. So now I was the project manager. And then along came a new CIO, and the state of Massachusetts said, okay, now every single entity in the state of Massachusetts must have someone who's in charge of computer security and information security. So as identity theft became big, as TJ Maxx's started to get compromised, as your parents probably had their credit cards compromised in various places, the state of Massachusetts said, okay, we need an information security officer in every agency, which meant in every school, and the registry of motor vehicles and the taxes and all those kinds of things. So we went about the process of trying to find someone who could do that. It had to be somebody who understood the technology, somebody who understood the people, somebody who understood how to get it all pulled together, who could read the laws, who could understand programming, who could, and the list just went on. I won't go through the whole thing. But eventually my CIO came to me and said, we can't find anybody. You want to try it? And I said, oh, that sounds awful. And I said, really, doesn't that sound like the most boring thing ever? And he said, well, your choice. So now a little bit about me again. I'm one of those people who, when someone does an evaluation of me as a job, they always say to me, you have to learn to say no. And I will admit to you that I'm 62 years old and it hasn't happened yet. So I said, okay, I'll do it. And I have to tell you, somebody asked, what's your favorite position? This has been my favorite position. I've been in it now for 7 years. I was the first woman in Massachusetts to be an information security officer for the state. I was the person who formed the committee of all the information security officers. I've gone to the other schools to train them in how to handle information security. I give seminars in faraway states. I get to do a little bit of traveling. I try to be as open to new ideas as possible because technology changes all the time. And to answer your question, I still go take watercolor and photography classes because that's where my love is. And now, instead of making it a job and trying to find someone else's idea of what creativity is, I'm doing it for myself. So that's about me.
Thank you so much. We couldn't have planned that better. That question followed
right.
by, because I knew what your background was, I was like, perfect.
As soon as you said it, I went, yes.
All right. Our next speaker is Jennifer Koch. Again, this is one of those areas that many of you may not be familiar with, so we were very excited to have her on our panel today. Jennifer is originally from Cleveland, Ohio, and moved to Providence, Rhode Island after graduation to pursue a career in food sciences. That, to me, if I had known about food science, I would have been all over that. She has a BS in biochemistry from Miami University and an MS in food sciences from The Ohio State University. I'm from the Midwest, so I totally know I have to say the. She currently works at Ocean Spray Cranberries Incorporated in Middleboro, Mass. As a product development scientist in the global beverage division, Jennifer's the primary developer of the new Ocean Spray beverage recipes in the Asian, Australian, and Latin American markets. So with that, Jennifer, we'll have you go ahead.
Hi, so I'm Jen. So I get asked all the time, what is a food scientist? Pretty much every week, people come up and ask me, what exactly do you do? So a food scientist is somebody who takes the chemistry, the biology, and the engineering behind what makes foods and uses it to do anything from developing a new food product recipe to making sure that food that's made in manufacturing facilities is safe and high quality. So I kind of, like some of the other panelists, you know, when I was in high school, I had no idea what I was going to do. You know, I knew I was good at science, but I kind of felt like it wasn't that interesting. But my parents had both gone to college and I knew I had to go to college, and so I just kind of picked chemistry as my first degree. And so I took a couple years of chemistry and then I decided to switch my major to biochemistry because I thought maybe that would help me get a job that I wanted, and I still had no idea what I wanted to do. And it really wasn't until my senior year of college that I went and sat down and looked at some job applications and sort of stumbled upon a position at Nestle called a food chemist. And I was like, oh my gosh, that is so cool. I didn't even could do that. And so here I was, like 3.5 years into my schooling, and I said, I have to do that. That's amazing. So I went and applied to graduate schools in food science, and I went and got my master's at Ohio State, the Ohio State University. And so I did 2 years for my master's, and then I applied to jobs, and I got an offer from Ocean Spray Cranberries out here in Middleborough. And I work as a product development scientist, so it's just one area of food science. And so basically my job is to, somebody from the company will come up with a great idea and say, I want to make a crayon orange or something. So they come to me and they'd say, Jenna, we want to make a crayon orange. We want it to be like really sweet, really refreshing. We want a lot of people to really like it. Or maybe they'll say, we want it to be naturally sweet and we want it to be low calorie. So they'd give me some sort of restrictions, and then it'd be my job. I'd go in the lab, start looking at ingredients, start putting things together, kind of come up with some recipes that I think would kind of fit what we want. So the next step then would be to take these recipes that we've got, and we actually do what we call sensory testing. So we bring in consumers, people just like you, to our headquarters out in Middleborough, and they come in and you would taste our prototypes, and you would say what you liked about them, what you didn't like about them, pick your favorite, and we actually take all the comments that the consumers give us, and we make tweaks to the recipes, and then we will eventually scale up and we'll launch it. And so the last part of sort of a project that I'm on, to take a recipe that I created basically in the kitchen in our lab space and scale it up to a huge manufacturing facility that makes thousands of bottles of juice an hour. And so it's sort of that last piece is more of some engineering where you actually figure out what sort of complications you can have. You know, it's one thing if I'm cooking something up on the stove, it's a total other if you've got a giant machine that makes, you know, pumping out tons of juice, heating stuff up. So that's essentially what a product development scientist does. But there's a couple of other areas of food science you can go into if you're interested. There's quality science. So I think Sharon mentioned like being a quality scientist. So when you're a food scientist, you go to quality. You're actually responsible for making sure that all the food is manufactured safely into a high quality. So you can have a desk job where you work more like looking at recipes and making sure things are going to, you know, be processed correctly. Or you could work actually in the manufacturing facilities on the lines every day, checking all the products that come off the line and making sure, you know, everything is meets all of our specifications. So people who are really good, analytically really pay attention to detail, make really good quality scientists. You can also be a food engineer. So if you're interested more in the engineering piece, you can get a degree in food engineering. I know a lot of people who actually just have regular old, you know, chemical engineering degrees go into food engineering. In that case, you can actually be responsible for designing the equipment that makes the food. So designing giant machines to, you know, dose out cookie dough or, you know, churn ice cream. So that's more sort of the manufacturing side. And another area of food science that I think is really cool is sensory science. So these people actually set up the consumer tests that we do. And so they know everything about taste, they know about consumer preferences. These are people who are actually good at statistics and analyzing lots and lots of data. So they put together these taste tests that we have people do, and they gather the data and they would come back to someone like me and say, looks like consumers think your beverage is too sweet, you need to, you know, dial back the sweetness. So if you were interested in food science, you can get a degree in food science as a bachelor's, but you can also take bachelor's degrees in things like, you know, I have a degree in biochemistry, chemistry, biology, statistics, engineering. You can get sort of entry-level jobs in the food industry, but if you were interested in sort of moving up over time, you would probably want to get a master's in food science. It's a 2-year degree. It's a ton of fun. People who are really interested in, you know, I really love cooking. I go home and I watch the Food Network every night. That's like my, that's what I do to relax. So, you know, I just love food science, and it's, I think we talked a little bit about, you know, people kind of think science is like this very dry sort of subject, and you have to be really good technically if you just only like numbers. That's absolutely not true. The best scientists that I know are people persons, you know, people who want to just talk and get to know other people and have empathy. They're able to kind of communicate and work with other people. You know, 90% of my job is talking to my coworkers, so you have to be really good at, you know, just figuring out what other people need and working with them, teams, Ryerson School, I hated working with teams, I'm sure many of you do. Many of us scientists really hated that kind of thing. But so it's not all numbers. A lot of my job is just being creative and just kind of talking to people. Yeah, so to be honest, every single day. So I work for Ocean Spray, obviously they have sweet juices, which have a lot of calories in it. And every day we worry about the amount of sugar that we put out in our juices. Almost every project that I've been on lately is about how do we take out sugar, how to make diet juices that taste just as good as regular juices. So every food scientist right now in the back of their mind is constantly thinking about how do we make healthier food that tastes great, that's natural, you know, everything that consumers want nowadays. So yeah, it's not, you know, pretty much everything I think about is keeping in the back of my mind, you know, how will this affect people's health when they actually eat it.
Yes. Do you think having that creative graphic design background assisted you in coming up with solutions when you switched to the STEM field?
Absolutely. Yes. Yes, absolutely. It was a good background in learning to, first of all, grab someone's creative idea and try to put it down so that they can see it actualized. And then just the technology changes in graphic design, which went from paste up and drawing to using computerized programs like Illustrator and Photoshop and all those kinds of things, make you go through the process of trying to bring out an end product that can be used and manipulated and changed. And this is all about what technology is doing. Shortening the process from something manual to something that can be repeatable real easy. And yeah, so going through the graphic design, I have no regrets not going directly into computer science. I'm doing it now, because if you work in an educational institution, you can take classes whenever you want at your institution. So to get the credentials now, I've taken computer information science and a lot of other things that I need for my own certifications. But yes, that original career choice was a great choice for me, and it made a perfect path into the technology field. Thank you.
Question. Any other questions? Yes.
When you got into Ocean Spray, was it about who you knew, or was it because that like your grades were so high? Like, how did you get involved in that?
So how did you get into Ocean Spray?
why put on an application? No, so it was really sort of mostly about my background. So I did not know anybody at Ocean Spray. The food industry is pretty small, so a lot of people do get jobs by knowing someone. But I was kind of the opposite. I blindly applied, just filled out an application, and they saw my experience in school. And actually, I did not have any internships or any external experience, which is really uncommon. And they basically just saw, you know, I'd taken classes, I'd done pretty well. I wrote a cover letter saying how, you know, interested I was in their company. And they brought me in for an interview, and we were actually just talking about this before you guys came in. A lot of when we see, like, people come in to interview for jobs, it's a little bit about sort of very little about your degree. They'll see that you have a degree. They'll look at your specific experience if you have internships or what you're interested in sort of outside of school. But I think, you know, 50% of it is just, you know, talking with the people and fitting in with the culture. So just being yourself in an interview. So I went in and I, you know, tried to be relaxed and just kind of was myself. You know, I laugh a lot, so I laughed a lot in my interview. And so I think really that's what kind of sealed the deal for me, was I kind of fit in with the company culture and like everyone just got along. And then I sort of had the credentials to back it up.
Yes, Kate.
I have a question for Ashley. Ashley, seeing that you're a BCC graduate, you started here at BCC, you now have a job at Sensata, which is a global company. I believe it has over 20,000 employees. Your first connection with Sensata was through one of these events, correct?
That is correct.
So why don't you tell them a little bit about yourself as a student and how you created that connection? You're saying that, you know, it's all about who you know. So how did you make that connection at an event like this?
Well,
like she said, I was just myself. I stayed after, didn't have anything to do, so I kind of talked. I was interested in the actual like sensors they brought in. And you just, like she said, you're just gonna fit in with the culture and you gotta talk to people, and they like people. One of my professors at Wentworth was saying that they look for people with personalities and passion. Passion's a big thing. You can't teach that to people. You can't teach somebody to have a personality. You can't teach them patience, and that's something that a lot of companies don't see in many people. Yes, you can be book smart all day long, but if you really don't want something, then how are you going to succeed in that? If you're just going to go with the flow. So I think that's something that she was talking about. She has that passion for it.
Was there a young lady back?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So just to clarify, Sherry, you do not have like an official degree or major in technology, right?
I do not, no.
And
I'm working on it, actually, but no, I don't.
You applied to be the district head of technology.
I did. And really, it all has to do, I gotta tell you, it all has to do with being willing to stretch yourself to a place where you're not totally comfortable. So I was just thinking about that path between being the people person, which I think I probably come across as being, so the help desk piece of it was a really good fit for me when they told me, because I, you know, I had gone along and said, okay, I guess I'm dealing with these people, but there's nobody who can handle this, building this network, so I will do that. I actually learned how to strip the wires, do all the electrical part, and build the wired network. And because I did that, somebody said, ooh, you know, you could probably get our systems for reporting up and running. So then I had to learn how to do operating systems and setting up servers and connecting to servers and then Active Directory. So it's just one thing following another. And basically when someone has said to me, can you get this done? Whether I know how to do it or not, the thing is I'll tell them, I'll find a way to get it done. So if I don't know, I go find somebody who does know, and that gets me where I have to go. So I went in my family from being the, you know, mother of two children and being kind of like the, you know, volunteer kind of person to being the breadwinner. And that's what I am now. So it's very true of many people I grew up with and know as friends even today, that women have progressed by just being willing to say, I will figure it out. And moving on from there. And sometimes figuring out means you gotta go take a class, like a networking class. I took a Novell networking class. So I took the classes and I just haven't finished up the degree yet. Getting been a little busy.
Two questions in the back, I think.
Yeah. I just had a quick comment because I thought it paired well with what Ashley just said and what Sherry said and what Jennifer has said. When you mentioned your daughter, Sherry, I think that's a very salient point.
Oh my
in
gosh,
our
yes.
Population. My own kids, people I teach here, you see a lot of students coming through advising who may have failed a Bio 121 class, and then they're like, I'm done.
Right.
I'm gonna go do a business degree because I'll be better at that business degree. But Ashley just said, if you don't have the passion for it, and that's what I try to tell my students all the time, I probably would have gotten higher grades had I not majored in biology, but I love biology. So I think that's a huge point, especially to you guys that are still in high school. Don't give up, because
no.
Nothing's
going to
be easy.
No,
not
don't
a single thing.
Don't
I had to
up.
Take Calc 2-3 times, so I definitely agree with you.
Okay, well, we tend to have the same, apparently, wavelength. I was going to incorporate along the same things, but I see it a lot because I teach in clinical laboratory science, and it's hard to make that exciting if you're not passionate for it. But with using your two daughters as an example, I thought that was a great example because we see people like that all the time. But you have to figure out what type of personality you are. There's online tests you can take on what your styles of learning are. Tell them I've taken like one of those. They all smell the same, but you can still keep doing it. But when you find out how you learn, you have to make it active. You have to make it interesting. You know, your daughter didn't have to read the book. I was the same way. You know, my sister, same as your other daughter. But we found ways to make it active and exciting, and it helps. I make my students come up with their own games.
I just want to add in that it was actually a junior high school teacher who put that passion for science into my younger daughter. And what they did is they built a nature trail in the back of the school. The kids did.
And then they stuck little GPS chips on turtles, and they tracked them for the three years they were doing this. And once she was hooked, and I won't say that she wasn't, well, almost at the edge of giving up on a couple occasions, and she'd say, "Mom, I can't do this. This is crazy." But she'd see that each time she did it again, she'd get a little bit better, a little bit easier to understand, a little bit clearer to her, and she just, you know, she could see the tangible successes as she went on. She just had to stick to it, and I am telling you, this has served her as an employee. The people who she works for know that she's a hard worker, that she will figure it out. It may take her a couple times to understand something, but once she's got it, she's infallible, and she just has this incredible spirit of being willing to go forward and work until she gets the job done, which is great. I think because she had to work so hard, that's exactly why she's like this. So it's been a good life lesson for her.
Okay, we'll take one more question in the back. Anybody has questions after this, please hold them. We do have another round of questions coming up.
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any advice on like people who are trying to go down the same path as you? So basically, like if you were looking for somebody to take over the position that you have now, what would you look for in the experience-wise?
As a matter of fact, I just hired a student who was a student at Fitchburg State to be an assistant security officer at Fitchburg State. And what I looked, he was not experienced with that at all. He was actually a film video major at Fitchburg State, but he worked at the help desk while he was there. And because he had great people skills, so when you're in security, you can be pretty threatening, and you can be walking up to people and saying, "Hey, you have XYZ on your computer, you need to get it off of there." And let me tell you, if you approach somebody that way, it's not going to work for you, because what you want is to know what's going on in your environment. What he has is the ability to go and say, "Hey, we have these tools that we use to try to make sure we're keeping everybody's information safe, and we notice that you're keeping stuff here when actually we'd really like you to keep it here on this safe server, so do you mind if I move it for you?" So the first time I saw him interact with people in an embracing way, not in a threatening way, because you can't be threatening in this environment if you want to be successful, I said, "This is the guy I can train." So now we've kind of split the applications that we use together, and he does some and I do some, and then we train each other so that in case he goes on vacation, I can do his job and he can do mine. And it's just a great partnership. So it's the partnership, the willingness to learn, and just that kind of intuitive nature about how you're going to deal with the job is the most important thing. He didn't have the technical thing. I didn't have the technical skills, really. We were learning those. So it's really about teamwork. It's about personality.
Thank you for your great questions. Hold on, we still have to go more opportunities.
Great. Just one thing I wanted to mention, too, that was said. You guys also mentioned the importance of teamwork. So later on, I'm hoping some folks will have some questions about that. Because I think that's also very important when you think about where you want to be going. So now we're going to hear from another biochemist who's taken her path in a very different direction. So our next speaker is Dr. Rachel B. Walcott. She has a PhD, she's an associate director of the Downstream Process Development and an assistant professor of medicine at Mass Biologics of the University of Massachusetts Medical School. Dr. Walcott received her BS in biochemistry from Providence College, and her PhD in chemistry from Penn State University. She moved on to conduct postdoctoral research at NIH, which is the National Institutes of Health. She was a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Chemistry at MIT, and after completing her postdoc research, she joined the Downstream Process Development Group at Mass Biologics in 2010. So thank you, and welcome Dr. Walcott.
Thank you. I don't usually hear Dr. Walcott. Rachel. compared to the previous four women that have spoken, I probably had the most straight path to my career. So I started off in high school. You know, I always liked math and science in school, and in high school I had, you know, as I was reflecting on my life, I realized that I went into chemistry because of my high school teacher. I had an excellent high school chemistry teacher, and she really ignited that passion for chemistry that I had. So I went to Providence College. So neither of my parents went to college either, and only a couple of my family members had gone. So my parents were very supportive, but they had no clue, right? So they were just kind of letting me choose my path and being supportive, which was awesome. But I couldn't rely on them to say, oh, do this, don't do that, you know, that sort of thing. So I went to PC, which was great. I did some research once I reached my junior year. I did some lab work, finally got into the lab. And that's when I said, you know what? I knew I liked the class stuff and I did well. And I realized when I started doing lab work that I really liked being in the lab. And I said, hey, I think I should go to grad school. And so I, you know, talked to some of my professors, and because I had no idea, again, what it meant to get a master's or a PhD in science and what you really did. I figured it was more classes and probably some research, but I didn't know. And so they encouraged me I said I wanted to do a master's because I said, I like the lab work, but I didn't know how much, I was nervous about it. And they just encouraged me to sign up for a PhD program because when you get your PhD, along the way you technically get a master. Some schools do an official master, some schools just, kind of lump it all in together. Because you can leave, if you start your PhD, you can leave. If it's not the right thing for you, you can leave with your master's, and that's great. You still have an advanced degree. I applied to a bunch of schools. I decided to go to Penn State, and that was primarily because there was another student that I was at PC with that was in the chemistry department at Penn State. He was a year ahead of me. He liked it there. So went to Penn State. That was an interesting experience. I worked for a brand new professor, and I think, my experience there was much like most of the other panelists, where I had to just figure things out. This was a new area for him, kind of, and it was obviously a new area for me. And so we bought all these instruments, and we had no idea how to run them, and we just had to figure it out. And we figured it out, and it really proved to me that I could do anything, really. As long as I had the interest, I could do anything. Along the way, during my PhD, I got exposed to the academia side of things. Being at a big school with lots of research, world class research going on. And I said, yeah, I think I want to do that. I want to have my own research lab and have students and stuff like that. And I liked teaching. And so I chose my postdoc training. So after you do your PhD, a lot of people will go on and do a postdoc. And so it's just a couple of years of additional training before you get into the workforce. And I chose my postdoc lab. I chose a group or a professor to work under that was a real bigwig in the field. And I did that so that, I could make a lot of connections and I could get that academic job that I thought I wanted. Well, so obviously you guys know the end of the story. That is not in academia. So along the way, when I was doing my postdoc, I saw he was very well established, as I mentioned. He had been in academia for probably like 35, 40 years. So very well established. His whole lab runs very, very basically on its own. And I looked at I looked at him and the hours he kept and the things he had to do, and I realized he's not just starting out. He's been in it for a long time, and he still has essentially no life. Like, the lab was his life. That was it. He went home. He had a family and everything, but that was his life. And I said, I don't want that. I need more from my life than just to be in the lab all the time. And so that's when I decided, okay, I'm not going to go into academia. I'm going to start looking for jobs in industry and trying to figure out what was best for me. I had a lot of skills that I had developed over time. I worked on projects, and I'm not going to get into what I worked on, but worked on a lot of different projects between doing like inorganic chemistry, really hardcore like synthesis kind of chemistry, and then also biochemistry. Like, I was growing bacteria and isolating genes from the bacteria, so very biology. And so I had a lot of those skills. So I just started looking for jobs that that I could use the skills that I already had, or that I knew that I could pick up quickly. So one of the tools that I used a lot in both my PhD and in postdoc training was protein purification. And so I found this job at Mass Biologics that was essentially all protein purification. And to me, that was always a tool, and it seemed kind of boring. So I said, hey, what the hey, I'll see what this job's about. And it turns out that the job that I have right now that I started with is really interesting job. So it is all one thing, it's all protein purification, but it's a lot of different types of purification, a lot of different types of proteins. So that part's interesting. But what's most interesting is I'm in the department called process development. So it's a biopharmaceutical company, so we make proteins for therapeutic purposes. And so process development, I had no idea what it was, as I mentioned, and no one ever told me about it, or I didn't know much even about industry. And so what process development is we bridge the gap between discovery research, so like really small, like Jen was mentioning, you know, like in your kitchen kind of thing, to the manufacturing scale. So we take the protein that was discovered by a discovery group, and then we make sure that we can produce it at high enough quantities with high enough quality so that it's safe for patients. And then we transfer that to manufacturing. So on a daily basis, I'm interfacing with our discovery scientists and also with our manufacturing scientists. So it's very, you know, biologists from really hardcore engineers that I have to interact with all the time. And I just had a discussion with someone the other day. You know, a lot of people think that discovery research is the cool, the hot thing to do, but discovery research stops at a certain point. Like, you can't just take what you did in the lab and give it to people and be sure that you're not going to hurt them. So you need that process development to be able to like, get that drug into people and really make an impact on people's lives. So I would encourage you all, I mentioned that I did some lab work over the summers when I was in my undergrad. I encourage you all to do that. Because you know, while my path was straight, you know, I did chemistry and then got into biochemistry. I realized that I kind of liked anything that I was doing. I've done lots of very different things, and I've liked them all because it's all, you know, science and it's all interesting. It's all problem-solving skills. So even if your job doesn't seem like it's something that you would be interested in, try it out, especially internships, because that's such a short period of time. And it also helps to build your resume, because a lot of resumes, you know, either with individuals with associate's degrees or bachelor's degrees, you know, they all kind of look the same. Everyone went to school, everyone did well, you know, majors in the same sorts of things. But that having that internship, we know, you know, as a hiring manager, we know that, okay, so, you know, maybe it's not even in something that's relevant to what my team does. I know that you've worked in a company before, you've had that teamwork that we've been talking about, and you understand the certain qualities that you need to be successful in a job.
Plan the placing of our speakers any better, because our next speaker is Rebecca Fenn, and she did do undergraduate research, so I'm hoping she'll speak a little bit to that as well. Rebecca is a research technician at Mass General Hospital in the Genetics and Aging Unit under the principal investigator, Dr. Rudolph Tanzi. This unit specifically focuses on molecular mechanisms of Alzheimer's disease and potential therapeutics to treat Alzheimer's disease. Rebecca received her Bachelor's of Science in Biology from Bridgewater State University in May of 2015. During her time at BSU, she participated in undergraduate research under the mentorship of Dr. Kenneth Adams. With her experience in undergraduate research in cell and molecular biology, Rebecca sought to find a job before entering her PhD program. So with that, we'll pass it over to Rebecca.
Hi, can you all hear me? Okay. You can call me Becca. So I went to Bridgewater State, and I went there as an athletic trainer. Not that. I took one athletic training course and was like, I hate this. Why am I doing this to myself? So I took the intro biology class that almost everyone has to take when they go to college, and I was like, I love this. Why am I not doing this?
So I changed my major sophomore year to biology. And I sat down with a wonderful woman who's at Bridgewater, and she was my advisor, and I said, I still want to finish in 4 years. And she gave me the look like, you're not going to finish a biology degree in 3 years. You're crazy. But I did. I did finish it in 3 years. And I proved her wrong, because you need to have passion and motivation. And if you love something, you just got to go out and do it. So I started my biology degree my sophomore year. And it wasn't until my junior year that I knew what I wanted to do. Because I was doing my biology degree and I was like, yeah, this is great, but I have no idea what I'm going to do with my life after graduation. So I took a cell biology class. And my professor, I loved him. He was so entertaining and the class was amazing. And I was like, this is the coolest subject ever. So I found out about undergraduate research, and he does undergraduate research. I really didn't have any idea what it meant. I was like, oh, that sounds cool. So I talked to him one day after class. I was like, can I ask you a question? And he said, yeah, of course, I have to ask you a question too, actually. And I was like, well, you go first. And he was like, okay, I want you to join my undergraduate research team. I'm like, what? I don't even know what that is. And he was like, oh, it'll be so much fun. And I was like, well, I was going to ask you about your research. He's like, great, you can do it in the lab. Like, come join me. It'll be so much fun. I'm like, I don't even know what you do. And he was like, that's fine. We don't know what we're doing either. Just come do it. And so I did undergraduate research the summer before my senior year and all through my senior year. And I also took a class the fall of my senior year about neurodegenerative disease, specifically focusing on Alzheimer's. And I fell in love. That sounds horrible to fall in love with Alzheimer's disease, but I did. And it is the most amazing branch of science. It's crazy. So I did that, and I knew I wanted to go into some field with neurology and neuroscience and disease, but I wasn't ready for grad school yet. I needed more time. I had good grades, and I was like, okay, maybe I'll go to grad school, but I just wasn't like ready experience-wise. So I decided, all right, I'm gonna get a job, and I'm gonna work, and then I'll apply to grad school. Who gets a job like with Alzheimer's? Like, what? They're like, oh, let's just Google Alzheimer's jobs. Oh, okay. But I did. That's exactly what I did. So I Googled Alzheimer's jobs, and you're never gonna believe this, a job popped up. And I applied to that job, and it was for the job I have now at Mass General. I was thinking to myself, yeah, right, Mass General, I'm not getting in there. So I actually knew about this job through my mentor for undergraduate research. And he was saying, oh, this place is great. It's called The Mind. They study neurodegenerative disease. It's really awesome. This guy, Rudy Tanzi, he's like the world-renowned Alzheimer's researcher. I'm like, yeah, okay, I'll go there and work. And I applied, and they were like, oh my gosh, you have such great experience in Alzheimer's and cell molecular biology. You want to come in for an interview? And I died. I was like, okay, this is happening. So I went, and during my interview, I was sitting there, and I'm like, freaking out. Oh my god, all these people are so smart. And not once did they ask me about like my classes or my GPA or my degree or anything. They're like, oh, so like, where are you from? I'm like, are you serious? What's happening? So they told me, like, just tell us about yourself. And I did, and I was myself, and it was great. And they're like, you did research? I'm like, yeah. Oh, tell us about your research. Because they just want to know, because they love learning. And I was like, oh, I did this. And they're like, this is so cool. Okay, so I think we're going to offer you this job. I'm like, what? And they're like, yeah, we're going to offer you the position. I was like, right now? And they're like, yeah. And I was like, seriously? And they were like, yeah, you know, you fit everything, you're super nice, we want to have you on our team, this will be so much fun. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm an adult, what is going on? I have a job. So I accepted a position at Mass General Hospital as a research technician studying Alzheimer's disease. So I get to go to work every single day and study a disease that millions of people are suffering. It is awesome. I love going to work. Who gets up at like 5:30 in the morning and is like, yes, I get to go to work. I hope everyone here ends up doing that, because it's great. So I get to go to work. The people I work with are amazing. And I work with a specific guy, his name's Dr. Raja Bhattacharya. Yes, try to spell that name. He is amazing. But I also work with a bunch of other people. The unit I work for goes down like an entire length of the building. and they all work with Alzheimer's disease, but different aspects of it. So I get to learn and experience things every single day. So the other day, a guy came in to do a lecture from, Northeastern, and he just came and talked to us about our research, and I got to sit there and get paid to learn, and it was awesome. And you just sit there the whole time thinking, oh my God, I'm getting paid to just learn. What is going on? Roles have swapped, what is happening? So just, I am a research tech now, and to be able to move up in this field and do what I wanna do, and have more like intellectual freedom and maybe get my PhD, I need to go back to school. So hopefully I get into a grad school program. I have to apply in the fall, cross your fingers. So once I do that, I'll be able to go to get my PhD. Not really sure where I wanna go yet. I'm thinking academia, but maybe industry, who knows. But I really just wanna get the point across that you just really have to push yourselves and be yourself. Because at first I was like, yeah, right, I'm not getting into Mass General, and my mentor, Ken Adams, was like, Becca, stop it. Like, you're great, you're fun, you're nice, just go and interview, you don't know what's gonna happen. And yeah, I had no idea what's gonna happen, because who the heck offers a job at an interview? No. So it was really great, and I'm gonna talk about undergraduate research a little bit. So I had no idea what undergraduate research was when I went to Bridgewater. And it was kind of like this like secret society of people who all did like undergraduate research, and they're like, oh, they do research, they're really cool. And everyone was like, I don't even know how to get into that. And come to find out, you just ask someone. It's really, really easy. Most of the time, they're looking for students to do research. So if you just ask a teacher, you're like, oh, are you doing research? They're like, yeah. They're like, can I help you do that? I'll totally be a part of that. And they will love it. So go talk to your professors when you get into college, make connections, meet people. Always just put yourself out there. It's really important, because I wouldn't be sitting here if I didn't meet all the professors I met in college. And I just really want to stress that. So do undergraduate research, get involved, and be yourself.
All right, questions? We just have a few more minutes left before lunch, so. Yes?
Rebecca, when you go to work, like, what exactly, are you like looking at microscopes and comparing like normal cells to like disease cells? Like, what exactly do you do in the lab?
What exactly do you do in the lab?
So it's different every single day. Today I actually went to work, this morning at 6:30, because I had to plate an experiment of cells. So I had to go into the lab and take my cells out of an incubator and plate them so Dr. Raja Bhattacharya could come in later today and treat them with an agent that we're trying to knock down a different protein. And this protein we think is involved in Alzheimer's disease. So when we knock that protein down, we take our cells and see what has changed, what's going on, what's different. So that's basically what I do. I work with a lot of cells. A group actually near me works with neurons and stem cells, which are really cool. And they grow brains. Yeah, let that sink in for a minute. Yeah, they grow brains in the lab. Alzheimer's disease brains, actually. So right now they're like really important, because they created this Alzheimer's in a dish. And it's really, really important for the field of Alzheimer's research. So there have been like TV people and like people walking around a lab recording me the other day. One was like, can we record you? I'm like, what? Why are you here? And I'm like, oh, Alzheimer's in a dish. I'm like, oh my God, I'm so sick of hearing this. But it's amazing. So I go in and I do my research, but there's also research happening all around me 24/7. So you just learn. Even when you're not thinking you're learning. And you just gotta go with it, because there's always learning going on. And if you want to learn more about what I do, you can ask me at lunchtime.
More questions? Yes, in front.
You mentioned that by merely asking for help or asking car selling to open a lot of doors, and I found that in my academic experience as well. I was wondering if the rest of you has also found that simply by asking, it got you places, or if you had to wait for it to be not quite handed, but offered.
So does asking get you places?
Definitely. I asked to go to the engineering club, and then
I go to her crying, I can't do this anymore, and I end up kind of get back in there and just do it. So sometimes it's just for moral support, sometimes it's for actual like academic reasons too. It definitely helps.
I think as far as my path at Mass Biologics goes, like I've done everything by action. Like I've moved up pretty quickly in the organization, and I just show that I can do the next job. So I don't wait for people to come to me and say, can you do this? I just go do it, and then they see I can do it, and keep going from there. So yeah, I would encourage you to just do the next job. Do your job, but do the next job also.
Yeah, I think sometimes like when I was growing up, I kind of felt like, how do these people get in these situations? Like, you know, who came to them and was like, you could do this, you could do that? It does not fall in your lap. You don't want to go out there and search for it. And I didn't even know what I wanted to do for years because I just hadn't searched far enough and hadn't looked into the right thing. So don't be afraid to just kind of, it feels really awkward to go up and ask someone like, hey, can I be part of your research group? Or like, hey, how did you get into that? Or like, what classes should I take? You know, don't be afraid to do that kind of thing because that's how your whole career will be made.
All right, we have a question in the back. Oh, sorry, did any other panelists want to answer that?
I just had a comment just to piggyback on what all of these students were saying is that if you go and you talk to someone, you have no idea if that person you're talking to, they come to you, you're like, oh, can I help you with your research? And they whip out a notepad with 20 different projects that are pending. You're doing them most of the time a big favor in approaching them. They can't just walk up to you on the street and sniff out your background and ask if you want to help with their project. So I think as a boss or you know as a supervisor, you appreciate that initiative. Otherwise, we're left just begging people to come on board. So I appreciate how outgoing you all are, and I think that it's huge to show other women that science isn't boring,
right.
And you guys are all funny and like animated, and it's very appreciated. I just, it makes science cooler, because it is
cool. And you approaching somebody kind of shows passion and interest, and that's something that industry's looking for now, because I think that's where we lack, so. You're doing that, it's like, oh, that makes you more motivated than the person sitting next to you that's afraid to approach somebody.
Yeah, and I'm sorry. No, it's okay.
No,
it's
all right.
No, I also think, too, that there are times when I've had people approach me and say, there's an opportunity, I'm kind of scared to go for it. What do you think? And right now I'm encouraging another woman that I work with to go, to really stretch yourself, and she doesn't have all the qualifications. But I see it in her, so I think also it's not always just like walking up cold to somebody and saying that, although that is really, really great. But I think it's also like kind of having people that support you and encourage you, and you can go to them and say, you know, I think I want to do this, but I might be scared, or what do you think? And to get that encouragement from somebody else, and you know, there are people, you know, that have helped me along the way, you know, the same sort of thing. So.
All right, we're gonna break here in just 1 second, but I just wanna piggyback on a couple of things that you folks just said that I think is really important. Yes, don't be afraid to ask. But secondly, do your research. Having passion is great, but as several of the folks here said, and Katie kind of alluded to there, you guys have it in you to research ahead of time. So when you go to these different schools and you go out to see the faculty, find out what they're doing. If you have a passion in that, and you come to them and let them know, and you actually can speak, and it doesn't have to be extensively, but just showing them that you've taken the initiative to figure it out, that's going to open up a lot of doors. And I think just like Ashley and just like Becca said, it tells that faculty or it tells that company person, hey, this person is actually really interested. The one thing I'll say, we had a panel discussion about a month ago, and one of the women on that panel also is very much like Sherry, and that she had, her background was education. She had her degrees in education, and she was now the VP of a biomedical facility. And it was all because she took the opportunity when she got into the company to constantly go down on the floor and ask people to show her what they were doing. Explain to me what you're doing. Let me figure it out. Let me learn the pieces of equipment. So again, your path may not be this perfectly straight linear path, but if you want to learn something, don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. Don't let mistakes be the reason why you don't do something. We learn from those mistakes, so take advantage of that and embrace it.